Okay, I'm back with a new video, and I wanted to do this in an email or a message, but I can't because the information that I got was a little bit strange and different and weird and complicated to explain in, you know, a typed or written message. So that's why I'm doing this video. It's about your Stafford mix. There seems to be a little bit of Black Shepherd or Black Lab DNA in it. Him. He's cute and gentle and kind and soft and nothing bad at all as for his character. There were some strange things going on. When I first introduced myself and stepped into his space, I saw a living room with a carpet and I saw him rolling around and he gave me the feeling of being bored out of his mind. And even though I stepped into his space, he wasn't able to come to me or connect or, you know, have a conversation of some sort. I don't know if you saw the video about that missing person girl where I spent days talking to a dog, a search and rescue dog that was completely obsessed with squeaky toys. And what's important for humans isn't always or almost is never, never almost is, I don't know, for dogs. So what we consider to be important, dogs don't give a shit about these things, apparently. I don't know what it is. That search and rescue dog was talking about squeaky toys for days. And I had to listen. In this case, I took another day to see if I was able to, you know, make the bond between me and the dog stronger and more powerful and more intense, so I could extract certain information that you might find useful. So I introduced myself. I tried to introduce myself. I stepped into this living room and I was just looking at a dog that was completely, you know, I don't know. First I thought maybe he has some kind of frustration, obsession, OCD thing going on where he makes himself roll on the ground, rolling around for hours and continuously and endlessly. And he just kept doing this rolling thing. And then I, you know, was laying on the floor with him and I looked around in the living room and there were, I don't know, some sort of curtains and a carpet and a couch. And from the dog's point of view, the interior of the room constantly changed, but fast and quickly. And the couch was here and two chairs were there, then the couch was here and the chairs were there, and some, I don't know, light, you know, lamp things going on, and a window, that's the only thing that kept steady and the same. But from the dog's point of view, these pieces of furniture constantly changed. That doesn't mean that your sister has an obsession for redecorating her living room, what seemed to be a living room. It can also mean that there's something in the dog's mind, in his experiences, in the way he perceives the world, that are unstable. I hope this makes sense. So I kept observing him and watching him and, you know, trying to stroke him and calm him down, because the way he was turning, making these turns and rolling around was, you know, all over the place, constant, non-stop, no peace, no relaxation, no calmness whatsoever. And then I started to wonder, well, you know, if a dog goes through something traumatic and strange and ends up in a place where he doesn't want to be, they become stressed and it's unable for them to relax. But I skipped a few years and went through the timeline, and at some point I was like, it's either his thyroid, that lack of exercise, that's absolutely certain, but also there's something in his throat, like his thyroid works too slow, which made him kind of uncomfortable and slow and chubby and ever so cuddly, but you know what I mean? I think you know what I mean. And then I thought, there's something wrong in his mind. The way he was rolling around and making these turns and, you know, just making circles and then dropping on the floor. First I thought it was epilepsy. And then I thought I went through all kinds of possibilities, but I think it was a little bit of a thyroid problem and not epilepsy, but dementia and some kind of tumor in his head that made him, you know, perceive the world in a way that he completely stressed out and felt horrible, and headaches. I had a throbbing headache when I initiated him into the empowerment ray. I had to do something to calm him down, because leaving him there in that place and leaving him like that wasn't an option. So I did a couple of healings and I initiated him in the empowerment ray to, you know, give him a boost. Same like, you know, waking somebody up from a coma or an antibiotic shot or something to, you know, calm something down. But I don't know, it didn't really feel infected by the way the living room constantly changed. And then the chair looked like this, then the chair looked like that, then the window was here and there, and the couch was there or there. Really reminded me of combination between dementia signs and some kind of brain tumor thing where, you know, I don't know. The brain gets sort of crushed by a tumor that presses into, you know, I think it was somewhere here, and I don't know, one eye might not have been working right. So so this night and tomorrow, this morning, I mean, I was finally able to, you know, call him to me and hold him, just hold him. And he was breathing and he was completely relaxed and he remembers you, which is a very good thing. But before, when all this rolling around and turning was going on and jumping on furniture and not allowed, being allowed to jump on furniture and hiding behind the couch and start rolling again, and owners getting crazy and frustrated and him doing more rolling, you know. Before, when that all was going on, he wasn't approachable whatsoever. So if you felt uncomfortable or unable to connect with him, there was a reason for it. And I think if you connect with him now, it's easier, you know. You can just, you know, hold him like a little baby and, you know, be gentle with him. And he wasn't biting me, because I was like, you don't know me. You have no idea who I am. I just stepped into your sort of bubble cage. And but, you know, he slowly came to his senses and made eye contact and came towards me, and I was able to pick him up, and he was quite heavy. But there was the couch and I sat down with him, and I didn't want to disturb the whole thing going on, so that's it. And then I thought, candles. Because I think you can, he's relaxed now, and that weird thing that messed up his perception of his world, his small little cage world, which the living room was, I think you will are able to connect with him and hold him like I was holding him. Now these candles, I bought one for Chica and I bought one for your dog. And these candles are fantastic. They burn for 60 hours, which is quite long. They are quite expensive. I don't know if you know this Renske. I think, well, there's English on the candles. So I think it's, you have Lilac Garden, Snowfall, Holidays for All, Apple Cider, Evergreen Forest, Falling Leaf, Fireside, Fresh Citrus, Moonlight, Memorial Candle. What I wanted to buy for, I wanted one candle for both your dog and mine, but it wasn't available. It's a memorial candle with flowers, citrus honey and golden vanilla. And then I ended up with, because this one wasn't available anymore, with evergreen forest with pine needles, dried leaf, redwoods, and sweet balsam. And this one, Fireside, with sandalwood, patchouli, kruidnagel, cinnamon, and bay leaves for yours. So, I think I will just keep this one and these candles, I don't know if you know it, but candles are toxic for animals. And these are expensive because they are specially made for if you have cats or dogs. Do you want your pet loving home to smell great? That's why One Fur All created pet house candles. We hand pour 100% natural soy wax, infuse it with our essential oil blends and add an odor neutralizer. It's long-lasting, 100% non-toxic and allergen-free. There's no better way to freshen your home. Well, it doesn't really freshen my home. It makes it warm and cozy and cuddly. Maybe if you use Snowfall or Moonlight or Fresh Citrus, then it brings sunshine in your home. But so if you can get your hands on this one, it calmed him down right away. Another thing that we talked about was toys, and I showed him a bunch of toys, this one. I hope you can see the brand, Beasties. I will put it in the description below. This is another, this is the same, same brand. You can hide. It's a Kong, but more funny. I don't know. Maybe your beauty likes this one also. And this one is, I don't know. It's just an egg, you know, for Easter. Perfect. This is what he wanted. So I already have this one and Chiara doesn't like to play with it. So that's for your dog. And this one I haven't tried out yet. I showed him, same brand, I don't know, they have cool stuff. He wasn't interested in a sheep. He wasn't interested in this duck thing either. He wasn't interested in one of these, not interested at all. This one is Vitacraft. He was a little bit curious about it, but not interested at all. This is a squeaky thing that fell out of a monkey, but I am making my own toys using old jeans and things like that. Not really interested, but curious. So this was curious and curious. And not curious at all, not interested. Interested. And then I have this one, which he really, really liked. And again, of course, if you can find something that, you know. So, repeat. Not interested. Not interested in homemade toys. Not interested in something like this. Slightly interested, little bit curious about this. Curious, but maybe because he's still healing. The whole ball throwing thing has to be, you know, reactivated again. Not interested in a dog, a duck thing, quack. Not interested in a sheep. Cool. Fun. Very interested in this. And this, you know, made him super happy. You have them in, it's a floating wobbly toy. You can throw it in the water, you can just, you know, throw it everywhere, it doesn't matter, you can just drop it in a garden and it wobbles. So that's what he was really interested in. And this candle made me very happy, but maybe, so toys, candle, healings done, initiation, empowerment ray done, toy, candle, healings, empowerment. And he finally was able to remember you and he wants to come home. So I'm not keeping him here. I am just going to send him your way, or you can just pick him up. I will just drop him on the couch and you can just enter my living room. Normally it's safe and secure and, you know, protected, but I will leave a door open for you to enter my home and pick him up, and that's that. You don't have need a leash or a harness or whatever. You just have to show yourself, reintroduce yourself to him and ask him to come with you, maybe bring one of the toys, and that's that. So after the initiation, last thing about your dog, he offered to be your familiar. And I know you have a dog, but this one really wants to come with you on walks and, you know, sleep next to your bed. And if you have it in your heart to spend some more money on a good candle and a toy, you know, you can create something that is his. Now, I don't think you have to be sorry. I know he was so confused and stressed, and there was something, the one that took your dog or stole your dog or whatever. If you are on top of your dog's health, she should have and could have noticed that there was something off in the way he behaved or started to behave. And she could have helped him, taken him to the vet, but it's done, you know. I would have been at the doctors, at the vets already with the first signs, but some people, I don't know what it is, but you don't have to be guilty, but he does want to come back. And I think the things that I showed you help you with, you know, make a better connection, make him happy and make him able to support you in making decisions and healing and guide you and, you know, make you creative and think about certain things and be more witchy and playful and find new joy and, you know, get your energy back and, you know, breathe, things like that. So that's it, and see you next time. Bye.